begin by sharing our announcements for this week. The bulletins for the month of April are dedicated to the glory of God and our loving memory of the following people: Herman Roy Ramsey by Marilyn and family, Kelvin McLennan by Joyce and family, Ernest Grigg by Irma and family, Annie Rollins by Wayne and Janice Trousdale, Sheila Wallfield by Tammy Coughlin, Chester Phillips by Laura and family, and Ernest Grigg by Rowena, Rachel, Daniel, Kendall, and families. Next week, we hope to have the family service at 9:30 in the morning here, followed by worship at 10:30 in Tyne Valley. You can find us online as well every Sunday evening at 7 through our YouTube channel, and the link is always posted on our blog and our Facebook page. Our weekly coffee chat continues Monday mornings beginning at 9:30 using the platform Zoom, and so you can contact me for the login details. This week we have meetings coming up. We have session tomorrow night, Monday, at 7 p.m. in person. Then on Wednesday night is worship committee at 7 p.m. And I do believe that'll be in person, but I'll let you know for sure. And then official board on Thursday evening at 7 p.m. And I will touch base around location for that as well, but that may very well be here. Finally, the annual meeting for Camp Abbey is happening on this Tuesday evening, April 20th, at North Bedeck United Church, starting at 6:30 p.m. They are looking for someone, at least one person from each pastoral charge, to attend, and they ask for people to register because, of course, they're restricted in numbers, and so the information is there for to call and register, and for those online, you can find it on our blog. And so now, come and let us worship. Come and see. Christ is here among us. Thanks be. Come and see, for Christ is here.
We come with eyes open to see Christ in one another.
Come and hear, for Christ still speaks.
We come with ears open to hear your words of hope.
Come, for Christ is here, arms open to welcome us into community with love. Let us pray. O God, creator of all life, we gather with thanksgiving in our hearts for all the ways in which your love shines in this world. We give thanks that in Christ there is life, there is love, there is hope. As we gather in community this day, may we be open to where Christ is calling us. This we pray as we join our voices together, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Our first hymn is number 589, Lord, Speak to Me.
Your joy that you have sought.
of scripture is Psalm 4. Answer me when I call, O God of my right. You gave me room when I was in distress. Be gracious to me and hear my prayer. How long, you people, shall my honor suffer shame? How long will you love vain words and seek after lies? But know that the Lord has set apart the faithful for himself. The Lord hears when I call to him. When you are disturbed, do not sin. Ponder it on your beds and be silent. Offer right sacrifices and put your trust in the Lord. There are many who say, oh, that we might see some good. Let the light of your face shine on us, O Lord. You have put gladness in my heart more than when their grain and wine abound. I will both lie down and sleep in peace. For you alone, O Lord, make me lie down in safety. And now a reading from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, verses 36b to 48. Wrong chapter. I found myself at 23, then it didn't make sense. While they were talking about things, Jesus himself stood among the disciples and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought they were seeing a ghost. Jesus said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scripture, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. O God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. So 2 weeks ago, we celebrated Easter Sunday, which is often considered to be a high point for us in the church year, alongside with Christmas. It's a joyous occasion as we celebrate together Christ's resurrection. It's a day when we give thanks for Christ and for all the ways in which we experience our own resurrections and the beauty of new life in Christ. But sometimes we forget that Easter Sunday is really just the beginning of our celebrations. The season of Easter continues for 50 days and invites us to hear once again the post-resurrection stories of Jesus and stories of the early Christian church. Stories that help us to reflect on how we experience Christ in our lives today. Because a key aspect of our Easter faith is the belief that in some way Christ still lives today, where we trust that all around us are signs of Christ's presence and the hope and light that he brings. Which is why we begin this season with what are referred to, as I mentioned, the post-resurrection stories of Jesus. Last Sunday, we heard from the Gospel of John, and today, our reading comes Gospel of Luke, where we hear about the disciples' first encounters with the resurrected Christ. Encounters that help them to make sense not just of the resurrection, but of the ministry that they were still being called to do. And so, when we turn to our reading from Luke today, you may notice it sounds a little familiar. I know for myself, I noticed that there were a lot of commonalities between our reading today and our reading from the Gospel of John last week. In both, we're told that Jesus appears to the disciples who are gathered together. In John, we're told they're actually in a locked room. It's very clear in both readings that the disciples are afraid. Again, in both, Jesus offers words of peace, and Jesus seeks to offer to them evidence that the resurrection is true. As well, Jesus encourages his disciples to believe in the good news and to reclaim their calling. In other words, Jesus seeks to push them back towards the path of discipleship and out into the world. Because although the women have shared the good news of the empty tomb, as I mentioned, it's quite clear that the disciples still aren't really sure. They're afraid and they don't know what the future holds. As Matthew Meyer Bolton points out, one way to interpret stories like this one is to emphasize how they narrate the resurrection, literally the standing again, not only of Jesus, but also of the community of disciples, moving them from inward-focused fear to outward-focused witness and action. Jesus' resurrection gives rise to the disciples' resurrection. And so Jesus knew that they needed one final push to undertake their calling as his disciples. And so we're told that Jesus teaches with them again in the hopes that they might find the courage to step out into the world in his name once again. And our reading today finishes by saying, "You are witnesses to these things." In other words, the disciples have seen him. They've heard him. They've known him before and after the cross. And now they must share what they have known with others. And this is true for us as well. As Bolton continues to write, Jesus' resurrection gives rise to the disciples' resurrection, and in turn they and we are sent out as apostles to help give rise to countless resurrections of others through changed hearts, repentance, and God's mercy, the forgiveness of sins. Which means that Christ's call to witness to his love in the world is our calling too. As an Easter people, we're called to live our lives in a way that proclaims the resurrected Christ in all we say and all we do, where our very lives proclaim what it is we believe, that love and forgiveness is not just ours, but for all people, that new life and new beginnings are always possible. So what does this look like? What does it mean for us to bear witness to Jesus and his teachings? Another reading that I read this week by Mark G. Vitalis Hoffman said, and this is his writing, "It's worth considering how Jesus is really real and alive in our world today. How do our eyes need to be opened to perceive Jesus? Where do we touch the hands and feet of Jesus? How can we provide food for the world that makes Jesus reality experienced?" So just as the disciples were witness to the physical, living, and breathing Jesus, we too have been witness to him, albeit perhaps in a different way. And so a part of witnessing to the good news is being aware of the ways in which we still experience the resurrected Christ. Because our Easter faith tells us that Jesus continues to live in us and in the world around us. Yet sometimes we can lose sight of this. be easy to miss the moments in which Jesus comes to us through all of creation, through the people we meet, through the animals and the plants, through all of the earth. And so we're called to be open to seeing and hearing Christ right here and right now. Yet we might wonder, how do we do this? How do we keep our hearts and eyes open to Christ's presence with us? It's not always easy to do. One way is to recall our baptisms, that moment in which we are claimed as Christ through the sign of the cross, a mark on our forehead which reminds us of Christ's presence with us and of our calling to follow in the way of the cross, offering and seeking forgiveness, sharing unconditional love, and creating hope and healing for ourselves and for others. Because we have been changed by Christ, and in turn are called to share that light and love with those we meet. We're called to share the good news that the past can be overcome, and that the love of God is stronger than anything else. So where do we begin? I love the suggestion from Hoffman that it begins by using our senses to experience Christ with us. That when we pause and let our senses guide us, we can experience Christ with us in a very powerful way. Whether it's taking the time to see the gift of life in creation, a butterfly that's flying by, a flower emerging from the soil in spring, the gentle touch of someone reaching out with love to help us when we need it the most, the sounds of joy and love that comes from a bird song. All these and more speak to Christ's presence and to the message of Easter. There's a reason why they adorn all of our decorations of Easter. But we must seek to be more attuned to Christ's presence. We must make the time to listen, to hear, to feel Christ, to listen for Christ's heartbeat within us and around us, by being intentional, by making space to hear and see what Christ is saying to us now, in this very moment of life. And so I encourage you to ask yourself, where have you seen Christ? And where do you experience Christ now? Seek him out, for he is there and here with hands extended, saying, "Peace be with you." So go and find him and hear him, and let your life be a witness to all that you have experienced in him today, tomorrow, and always. Amen. So now we'll join in hymn number 603, "In Loving Partnership We Come." And now let us join in our affirmation of faith that's found on the back covers of Voices United. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect in creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus, crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life, in death, in life beyond death. God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. We come this day, O God, with Easter joy still bubbling in our hearts. For all around us are signs of new life. Birds singing, grass and trees gaining color, flowers blooming under the warmth of the sun and the welcoming rain. All around us, creation is singing with joy and inviting us to join it. And so, O God, we raise our voices that we might join in this Easter song. Yet even as we sing our joy, we know there are many of us who struggle to feel it. And so we lay our worries and concerns at Christ's feet as we pray for all who grieve the loss of a loved one, a job, a home, a familiar routine. For all who feel alone and unloved, for all who live in fear due to violence in their home, in their community, in their country, for all who feel they have nowhere to turn. We especially remember, O God, all those who mark a very somber day, a day this past year that was marked with extreme violence in our sister province of Nova Scotia. We hold all who are remembering loved ones, experiencing trauma, revisited, as they seek healing and a way forward. As we celebrate the resurrected Christ, we pray that we might remember our calling to be Christ's hands and feet in this world, sharing love and hope to all who need it. As we pray in Jesus' name, amen. I'll now share our minute for mission for this morning. So it's entitled, The Incredible Differences Your Gifts Make, Bill's Story. None of us can go a single day without having an impact on someone's life. And we can't always predict how what we do to help change a life might wind up changing ours. Take Bill Darnell. Bill's love affair with nature began at camp, but it didn't end there. Far from it, Bill's childhood experience at camp wound up inspiring one of the world's most influential environmental movements. Camping had a big effect on me. I grew up in suburbia and didn't have much access to the natural world. Camping was an opportunity to go out and be in nature. It was amazing. Being at camp solidified my strong connection with the natural world, he says. But Bill's early camp experience instilled such a love of nature that when he became an adult, he became an environmental activist. When I was 25 years old, not far removed from my years in camp, I saw that they were testing nuclear weapons. That was so obviously wrong that I felt I had to do something to stop it, he says. So Bill and a small group of friends anxiously climbed on board an 85-foot fishing boat, later dubbed Greenpeace. Together they set sail for Alaska to stop the testing of nuclear bomb. Greenpeace as a movement was born. Bill's story proves that camping experiences in childhood can lead to a lifelong commitment to care for God's creation. As scientists and activists sound the alarm around climate change, and experts report that not spending enough time outside is having an impact on our children's health and well-being, outdoor ministry has never been more crucial. It's just one of the many reasons why mission and service really matters. Your mission and service gifts support over 24 United Church-run camps across the country, and that would include our Camp Avenue. Every year, your generosity gives thousands of children an opportunity to go to camp. There, they learn life skills, meet other campers, explore faith, and spend time outside. Like Bill, some young people may leave camp so impressed by the natural environment that they get on board a movement to take care of it. Camping made an incredible difference in my life. I know it will make an incredible difference to young people across Canada. I give thanks to those who support it, Bill says. Please make a gift to Mission Service today. Your support not only makes a difference right now, but also has an impact on the future for all of us who are blessed to live in the beautiful world God created. And so now we pause and celebrate and give thanks for all of our gifts. The gifts of time we share, our gift of talents, and our financial gifts which help to make a difference in God's creation here at home and around the world. Let us pray. We offer our gifts, O God, in the name of Christ, who invites us to participate in his resurrected life in this world. May what we offer bring hope and new life to all those whose lives these gifts touch. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 635, All the Way, My Savior Leads Me. Inspired by the love that has been given to us. that we might bring hope and love to all. And as we go, let us go with the blessing of God our Creator, Christ our Redeemer, and the Holy Spirit our Sustainer, this day and forevermore. Amen.
One more announcement. Jerry Ann had a birthday this week, so maybe we could sing happy birthday.
Hunter's got a birthday in 2 days. Hunter has a birthday on the 20th.
Oh, and Hunter too! Wow!
Happy birthday to you!
Tuesday.